Hello everyone. I'm Ákos Hadnagy. I'm a student at TU Delft and a Google Summer of Code participant. And I will be giving a talk about cloud FPGAs. But first, let's start with the question. Have any one of you used any cloud FPGA tools? Yeah. Was it easy? Yes? That's surprising. OK, that's a kick in the stomach, because I used those and it wasn't a pleasant experience first. But let's save it for later. So first, I'm going to talk about opportunities for cloud FPGAs in hardware design and both in open source hardware, then about some hurdles of the adoption, then a framework that set off to solve all these problems or a subset of them, and some recent developments I made for it. And I'm going to close the presentation with a demo. So, cloud FPGAs. Recently, FPGAs made their ways to the data centers. And it's quite interesting, because now you can get into the hardware design and FPGA world without actually having to own an FPGA, which could be said it's a barrier for enthusiasts and hobbyists. And also, if you think big, you can have very interesting compute models coming up. And also, it maybe proposes a way to cloud hardware development tools with deployment integrated. But what's standing in the way? As I said, I use these tools, and it took me quite a long time to figure out, even though I knew Vivado quite well. But the infrastructure itself is quite complicated, at least for a beginner. And FPGA design is hard, it still is. And also, you require a lot of vendor-specific tools for that. I mean, there is a way in open source to use FPGAs with just an open source stack, but not for cloud FPGAs. These are big ones. And these tools are not built for hobbyists, let's be honest. And there is also the communication layer, which has to be solved. It's very flexible, but quite complicated to use right now. And here is the solution, or one of the solutions. So first, CLaaS. CLaaS stands for Custom Logic as a Service. It's an end-to-end framework in two ways. One of which is it holds your hands from the first minute of the development until the deployment of your application. And the other is that it's a complete stack of layers from your FPGA hardware kernel to JavaScript. And there are a ton of target applications, obviously all buzzwords. We had to put them there. But what you can see here is the architecture of the framework. So everything's in a white or gray box is delivered by the framework, and the green ones have to be delivered by the user. So that means the FPGA kernel and the client application. You have a very simple streaming interface to your FPGA kernel, and on the other side you have WebSockets or sockets you can push data into and receive. So this tries to solve the communication issue between the FPGA and the host application in a convenient way. So let's take a look at what kind of development flow. What kind of development flow is there with this framework? So you have your local development machine. One of the features of the framework is that it pushes the use of cloud vendor tools to the very last step of the development, to the optimization and deployment. During the summer, I integrated very later into this framework, so you can do your iterations locally on your machine, and this is an in-the-loop simulation, so you can use the same host application as you would use with the FPGA kernel. And when you feel that your application is ready, or at least you're ready to try it out on real hardware or use the vendor tools to optimize it, you have two ways. I integrated Terraform infrastructure management as well. That means you issue one command and you can deploy your application in Amazon AWS F1. Either to a production instance that doesn't have any fancy stuff on it, just the runtime. So you issue the command, it fires up the F1 instance, and you get back an IP address, and there's your application running with the WebSocket interface. And there's the other one. You can deploy a development instance if you want to further optimize your application. And you can run all the Sylinks, vendor-specific tools, get an RDP connection. Actually, you get a configuration file, so you just have to open it with Remina. So it's quite easy. And you can get all the timing information and everything that Xilinx tools give you. And you can do your iterations here as well. But if you're finally ready, you can run your production instance with one command. And I brought some usage examples. And this should be a demo, but we pre-recorded it, because showing a demo is the best way to show broken software and have embarrassing moments. So. And as they say, a picture is worth a thousand words. This is a video, so you can imagine. It's divided into three parts. One is just running an out-of-the-box example. The second one is running it on an actual FPGA in Amazon F1. And the last one is just to modify an application to serve another purpose for you to show how easy it is. Let's see. Going to start. No. Yes, embarrassing moments, as I said. Nice. Just give me a sec. Just have to push it to the end. Yes. So there we go. Now I just have to start it from the beginning. And I lost the mouse. All right. So you have a tool that you want to try out this. You just search for the repository. It's called FPGA Web Server, because that was the framework's name not long before. You just go to the Getting Started menu. You copy three lines of code, three lines of instructions. Two of those are actually CD and getting the Git repository. And we have a quite powerful init script that installs everything for you. We are planning to Dockerize all this, so it will be even easier. And it takes a few seconds. And after that, you just issue a command that you want to try this out locally. And it will build a validator model. And right away, you have your simulation ready. And you can just connect to the application through your web browser. There we go. This is a Mandelbrot fractal rendering application. As you can see, this is the C++ example. So we actually implemented the C++ version of this kernel as well, just to be able to compare with the FPGA and very later version. As you can see, it gets quite laggy with bigger images, but this is what you expect. And then we change to the simulated version. And what you should see here is not that bad. So if you would use the vendor simulator on Amazon AWS, it also simulates the shell logic around your kernel. And it's like two orders of magnitude slower than the very later model. So it really has advantages developing on your own machine. And the next stage is to deploy this in Amazon. So we're going to use a pre-built image, because it still takes a long time to build an FPGA image. And Terraform is going to provision you an AWS F1 machine. It takes around 4 minutes to initialize that. Obviously, we cut that part. So it's going to be faster than that right now. And you don't need anything for this, just an F1 account with actually you need to be allowed to run F1 machines, so you have to as a support first, because not everybody's allowed to do that yet. So actually it's running, we connect it to the instance on the IP address, and it's running there. So again, C++ version of the kernel, it works. It's gonna be slower with larger images, of course. And yes, it gets quite laggy on an F1 machine. But if we switch to the FPGA version, it's quite a bit smoother. And I want to point out that this uses only 5% of the FPGA, so there wasn't a huge effort put into the to make this optimal. There's a lot of room to improve this, but this is just a demo application, so don't expect too much. And the last part of it is to modify an application. So, which is going to copy a simple VAD example that is actually the example that Amazon gives you to try out the infrastructure. And we're going to name this application Toy. You open whatever text editor you have, and you can start modifying it. So this is actually written in Verilog, this application. And we're going to modify it from increment to decrement. So it's going to decrement the received values by 2 instead of adding 1 to them. It's a very complicated test, but it's enough to show you the basics. So that's going to be -2. And we can issue the same command as we issued in the first step to run locally, simulate it. And we built a very simple web interface to interact with this. So here, we're going to send this number to the kernel, and we're going to receive the values back. Yes, there you go. So we send 16 of these just for testing purposes, and we receive the correct values back. So actually, this is what I wanted to show you, but let's take a look, where are we now? So what's standing in the way? FPGA design is hard, it still is, but we have new languages, mostly driven by the open source community, by the way, which is quite nice. Vendor-specific tools required, we tried to push this as far as we could. This is where we are, just the last step of the development phase. Commercial FPGA tools are not built for small-scale application. Yes, our infrastructure feels a pain, not you. We spent months figuring out this. You can just issue a few commands to use it. And the communication layer between the application and the FPGA, yeah, there it is. This is fundamentally what we try to solve. So thank you very much, and I'm open for questions. I'm all ears.
Assuming I have like a Kintex FPGA connected to the PCI Express of my workstation, can I use this to interact with that?
Well, not really. It's really built around the F1 infrastructure, so we currently only support that. There's a question, yeah.
So, two questions. All the Xilinx IP, is any of that encrypted? Is there any, I mean, we use F1 and we instantiate all of our DSPs and Ultra RAMs manually. If I do that, can I run that through Verilator?
So the thing is that we don't use any Xilinx IPs on the local machine, because we don't include the shell logic, nothing, just our kernel. So okay, you only start using the Xilinx infrastructure when you actually deploy the application in the cloud. So everything's open source until you go out of your machine.
Right, so I can't use it for my current designs, because I instantiate the block RAMs right away, so I need a simulation model of the ultra RAM.
Yes.
Okay.
So and this is just a cycle accurate variator simulation.
Right. And the second question was this, what kind of, you know, speeds are you getting through the PCIe bus? Can I, how many gigabytes per second am I getting through this system?
Probably you're not going to get that. At least that part of the infrastructure is not quite optimized yet. On the other hand, it's really built for compute intensive and compute bounded applications. So this is probably not that kind of application where you need a lot of memory bandwidth, for example.
Okay.
Potentially a daft question, my apologies, but how do you see the results? I mean, showed us the a Mandelbrot set. Does it create a virtual screen on your web browser or a virtual serial port? I mean, how do you get the outputs?
So we have an interface, a WebSocket interface. We defined commands and data packets. So you have to build your own application front end to interact with it. But it's quite easy because you have a standard socket. You just have to stream data into that.
So if there are no further questions, let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.